Okay, ladies and gentlemen, Law Lift. And you're going to speak nice and loudly. And the other one?
Can I just get
this one here. The nice worn button. Yeah.
So that's all.
Good to go.
4 years ago, Ali travelled to Australia with his cousin Mohammed. They both submitted their asylum applications. Mohammed was lucky enough to have one in four in Afghanistan. His application was processed without issue. Ali, however, had a patchy work history with times when he was unemployed in construction. His application was delayed because the department needed more information about these gaps. During the application delay, government Australian policy changed. Mohammed got his permanent residency, but Ali is now stuck in limbo on a bridging visa. If Ali knew he needed to add the times when he was unemployed on his application, his future may now be different. We want to help people understand how to complete their complex applications. Anything that we can do to educate people about their forms will help set up their applications.
Language in our chatbot can be made simple. Hello, work history is an important part of your application form. Was there a time when you did not work for a person or business for money?
Yes.
You said yes, there was a time when you did not work for a person or business for money. What were you doing in that time?
Nothing.
You answered nothing, but that answer will not be accepted on the application. The department will not process that answer. They'll come back to you and ask for more information. Let's chat about what you were doing.
I'm looking for work.
Great, you were looking for work. What sort of work were you looking for?
Construction.
Between which dates?
December 2010 to May 2016.
Thank you, that's great. So remember, when you go back to your agency lawyer to complete your form to tell them about this time, you were looking for a job in construction and not actually working.
Okay. So this example gives you a great indication of just how user-friendly the chatbot is. And furthermore, that application is available in a range of different languages. So if the applicant struggles in English, they will be able to do it in a range of different languages and really help assist with their application. So this is how our template for the application would work. As you can see, there's an easy landing page, and then there's a lot of different alternatives from where you can go from there. Ending with a lot of different exit points, such as form selection, and other alternatives such as citizenship and study and working for later on. So this is the interface of the front end. So this is an example of if they had a particular problem with section A. So they would click on it, and then they would be redirected to an easy to use chatbot, as we just saw previously, and they would be able to work through their application together. So our go-to-market strategy revolves around our potential supporters. These are the supporters that we've contacted in the past and present, and they were a major help in assuring us that our market acquisition model was useful, because we weren't sure whether refugees would pick up this application as easily as we thought. But these guys assured us that 95% of all refugees have phones, which would make it easy for them to pick it up. Additionally, these ambassadors are people that are very, very enthusiastic about the refugee situation in Australia and would really help us get the message out there, coupled with the go-to-market partners. It's particularly significant right now because the 790 form is expiring in October, which means there's a huge amount of demand for people getting ready to finish this application. So lawyers are stretched enough as it is, and there's a huge market for people wanting to fill up this form. So what we would see is, as we help people with this form, we would use that as a springboard into other forms and lots of different alternatives for just helping these guys get through their applications. So there'd be an initial decrease, as obviously we made a very, very easy to use application, and then a rapid increase as we spread out in terms of customer acquisition. So in terms of the global context for this, there's easy expansion. As long as we have a suitable chatbot at its core of this, and the languages, it's basically unlimited. If we have offices and things in different nations, there is a continuous flow of desperate refugees that need someone to help them understand their applications. So the potential impact of this is a really, really important thing to finish on. sometimes we get straight away from, you know, whether this is for making money, but it's not. It's about helping these people really identify with the opportunities that Australia is so proud of. Thank you. Maximising customers, and we'll be developing the partnerships with the relevant organisations.
As in, would it be paid for, or?
So it would be free to use for the refugees.
Yeah.
And then the way we would generate revenue, there's a range of different possibilities, but through optimising the supply chain from the governments to the non-for-profits, we believe that there's strong partnerships that can be made there.
Thank you.
Mine's a similar sort of question. So once it's set up, the government or legal aid agencies would be paying your group for dissemination, but how does that?
We can see, well, my background's in open source, so we've talked about using this as an open source application, and therefore it can be used and contributed to others because the content is really key within this. So the focus is on the time that an agency can save with processing an application, so that's part of the value for that agency, and then potentially branded and potentially branded and use it as an internal resource tool that they might use for people that they're supporting.
Thank you.
What's the plan if you win or not win?
I think either way we're all very enthusiastic for moving forward. I think if we don't win, I think we can still follow the same process. A lot of us for university students would be able to access those sort of channels. But either way, there's definitely an immediate push to get this done before October the 1st. So make a really basic beta that would enable us to get it out there as quickly as possible and help the refugees struggling with that 7-9 reform. And then sort of push off that. Either way, I think winning would help speed it up a little bit, please. but yeah, either way, I think we'll be okay.
Terrific. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well done.
Off the TechFugees Australia Facebook page.
Is it?
Yeah. Who's got the clicker?
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I threw it away. No, I'll come to you.
We can just click through. You've set up.
Yep.
Okay.
Imagine you're someone who is disabled, can't speak English, and can't live properly. You lost both your daughter and wife in a war in Syria, and now you only have a seven years old boy. You have to take him everywhere just because he can't speak a little bit of English. How do you feel? Do you feel like you're having a happy life? No, you feel incompetent. The story that I just mentioned is the life of one of my dad's friends called Ahmed. He came from Syria a year ago. He's 45 years old and he desperately needs help.
And this is where our app, Errand Assist, comes in. With Errand Assist, we plan to connect people in need of help with people who can help them. There are two groups that will be relevant to our product. First, the assistant. When the assistant open the app, they will be presented with a few generic options, such as shopping, driving, or dishes. And they'll be able to put in their language, fill in a generic Mad Lib-like list by putting in their relevant information. It might be, hello, my name is blank, and my blank broke. Could you please fix it? By focusing down on the one-word translations, we can make it so we can avoid the grammar, we can bypass the grammar problems of translating things. Then that message will be sent out to various corporate, will be sent out to the assistants in the, will be sent out to the assistants in the nearby area, and those who accept will be able to come back. The assistants themselves will have a very different experience with the app, of course. When they open it, they'll be presented with nearby options along with points next to them, and a total points at the top. When they complete a job, they'll be able to mark that off and gain the points. Those with points will be able to look in their points section and find a leaderboard. Those at the top of the leaderboard might receive prizes, for example. The people that will be working as assistants would be people such as RAA or Red Cross. And the people who would be assisted would be refugees, specifically those that are disabled or that have language barriers. We want to make it so that we get to about 81 assistants. enough people so that we have one person per kilometre of the inner suburbs of Adelaide. And then we can make it go public. The public model would be a little bit different. Without the focus on refugees and disabled, it would be more about just people being able to do what they don't want to do. You'd be able to make it so you can put up an ad of sorts that I would like someone to do my dishes. I would be willing to give X amount of dollars to do that, and someone nearby can say, okay then, and go in. And we'd take a percentage of that revenue. This wouldn't sacrifice the refugee issue either, because we can use special logins to allow them to continue using this system.
Thanks to our mentors, we not many think about problems that refugees might have faced or facing, and as well as expanding our knowledge about how we can help them in different ways. One of the examples was Anna, who talked about security problems. She was the main reason why we changed our plan a little bit, so we don't have any security problems. Our original plan was to create an app where everyone can help each other. However, as I mentioned before, because of the security problems, we decided to change it a bit. We decided to start the app by letting volunteers become assistants because they've done their police check before.
So, have you heard about volunteer good for well-being? 10 museums in Madrid did a 3-year study on that, and they discovered there was an incredible increase in volunteer well-being, 75% even. Not to mention 20% increase in volunteer employment and general confidence.
I would say our biggest risk is lack of money. How to get the funding to run the server? The cost of developing the app. We can only go so long acting as the tool of volunteering alone. At the start, our big idea was to have all this for free. But both of our sake and for the sake of incentivizing people to help, we had to use cash instead of points.
So, our aim is to finish our programming within 3 months. In the following 3 months, we will distribute the apps to corporations. And within a year, when we earn enough funding, we will go to other cities and eventually worldwide.
Adult assist can impact a range of problems that refugees are facing nowadays when they first arrive to settle in Australia. As there is a huge complication of understanding English for unqualified refugees, and due to some disabilities, it's hard for them to go out and get their needs. Our solution explores every aspect that refugees face.
And imagine, if Ahmad would have access to earn assist, he won't be spoiling his son's time or asking other people to help. He could get help from some people who are bilingual or there without any difficulties. By using this app, his life would become easier and maybe a little bit happier. So let's start from today to help people such as Ahmad to have a better life.
Smartphone or use technology and order something or request something for anyone arrived in Australia is like 60 or 70 years is disabilities. Can they use this app?
So one thing we didn't get to talk about because of the time is we wanted to make sure that there was various problems we came across, such as arthritis would be an obvious problem for being able to type, even though that's probably some of the people that would need it most. So we wanted to make sure that there was a easy voice option as well to just fill it in. You've got 2 words to be able to fill in, which should be able to pick up. There's technology that already exists, open source stuff such as what Google's got, and you could just, so there should be a little like button around the bottom where you can click it, and it should change to a voice mode, as well as being able to permanently do it in settings.
Sorry, I didn't quite get the, so you said you changed it from money to points?
From points to money.
So how would it work? So if someone is,
so there would be, so originally we planned to do it with volunteer groups such as Red Cross and that.
Yeah.
So that would just be points, a general like, okay, we're giving a little bit of incentivization to people to be able to do this.
Yeah.
And it's more of an inward thing. You'd have little groups. In Red Cross, it might be the person with the most might get a bunny or something around Christmas.
Mm-hmm.
And then it would be for the public version, which it's harder to try and get points to incentivize people to help with that.
Yeah.
It would be more about cash distribution, more like a kind of generalist Uber, if you will.
Okay, and how does Errand Assist make the contribution out of that? How would you get some?
Well, the hope would be that since we already have a base system and a few people set up there, their one would also work with the base system. So we'd have a base of people, and we could then advertise, given how much, based on how much budget we would have to do that, to say, okay, then we've now got this thing where you could do that. If we had enough money, the ultimate goal would be to set up something so that you would join in and you get X amount of credits at the start, which you could automatically start going in the PayPal model. And then we would hope to take it. So when you put some in, you would then have a percentage of the credits stay within the app. So you would eventually grab enough that you'd say, okay, maybe I'll ask for something.
I get it. Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Any questions? Oh, well done. Terrific. Okay, big entrance from Wiblicka.
Hello, everyone. We are refugees. Welcome, Australia.
Next slide, sir.
So Ali is an asylum seeker living in the community. He has limited income and he can't work legally. He runs out of money almost every fortnight and he can't afford to buy food because his rent's too expensive, so he's looking for housing alternatives. Brian's a 30-year-old young professional who's frustrated at the way asylum seekers are treated in Australia and is also frustrated that he has limited avenues to give back in a tangible way. He would like to offer his room to a person seeking asylum. So at the moment, the problem we're solving is that there's a disconnect between people seeking asylum who are looking for accommodation and hosts who are willing to give up their bedrooms to refugees and asylum seekers for free. Refugees Welcome Australia will facilitate that connection so Ali and Ryan can live together.
All right, so here is our solution. We have a website that's been run by the Refugees Welcome organisation at the moment, so we're thinking of expanding that website and adding an app into the ecosystem. So there's two things that the app can do. It will match the host and it will match the asylum seeker. So there's two sections, a host section and an asylum seeker section here. This is what the asylum seeker will see. So the asylum seeker will choose where they're looking for a place to stay, or if they haven't decided that yet, they'll just say, yeah, I'm feeling lucky, show me all the places to stay at the moment. And then they'll come up with potential matches. So in this case, Ali will see Ryan. There'll be a short bio about Ryan, some reviews if Ryan has hosted before, and some ratings as well about Ryan. Now, what we're trying to go for is sort of a colourful, vibrant, Airbnb-esque to our app. Now, that will add sort of like, make it more likeable, add some credibility as well. So Ryan will also feel like he's got some incentive because he gets a rating. Overall, it's just trying to make the app look a bit better and make it more approachable, add trust to people, because we think that trust might be a big issue here. All right, and on the next slide, we've got what Ryan will see. So Ryan will then be paired with an asylum seeker, in this case Ali. Now, we'll have some details about Ali, again, a bio, how long he needs a place to stay, and where he's from. So after that, what we have thought is we need a way to match these two. So we're thinking we need to profile these people. And what we've done is we've spoken to some asylum seekers, we've done some research and we've done some surveys as well. So we've come up with some questions that range from things like languages, skills, hobbies, to more personal things like smoking, alcohol consumption, and whatnot. So we can streamline this matching process between the two. Another thing that we found quite interesting was that often asylum seekers come here and they're not sure what amenities are provided in the accommodation. So the host will be able to say, okay, we've got Wi-Fi, we've got a computer for you to use so that you can call people back home, and also electricity, water is paid for and whatnot. And yeah, so once they've matched, they've profiled, they are able to chat to each other and we'll go from there.
So the opportunity and the potential impact. There's 24,000 people seeking asylum living in the community and more refugees in the community too. There's 7 million empty bedrooms. We've done some market research over the weekend and 40 people completed a survey. Of them, 50% would consider giving their room for free for an average of 1 to 3 months. How we're going to reach our market is through Facebook, so we're going to try and direct market through Facebook to both refugees and hosts. We also aim to partner with settlement services and government agencies to get referrals for refugees and asylum seekers to our app. Our funding and our business model, we've done a lot of work on over this weekend, and We've discovered that Airbnb has made a commitment to house 100,000 refugees globally. They haven't reached this target, and it doesn't look like they're going to. We've already reached out to them, and we think we can solve their problem, and there's definitely a market opportunity there by solving that problem. In the short term, we can look at options like crowdfunding, subscription platforms like Patreon, and other grant funding. And I think there's another market opportunity in the tech can be used in other markets, such as aging and homelessness, where house sharing could be a potential solution. Our competitors in the refugee space, there's the Community Placement Network and Enough Room. Both of these started, but the process was so labour intensive to make the connection and facilitate it in a safe and trusting way. We're using our technology to streamline that process, ultimately making the model scalable. Here we are. I'm Theo Campbell. I'm a social worker. We have Philip, who's an app developer, Ifran, who is a web developer, and Kathy, who is a game designer. What we need mentorship. It's been so good to have mentorship over this weekend. Well, they've made a sort of very public commitment to house 100,000 refugees, but they haven't been doing it.
They haven't been able to do it. They haven't been able to do it, which is why they.
Do you know why though? Is that demand or?
Not exactly. I think just a return, like a good return for the communities, like to give something back, basically.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think they've released why they haven't been able to do it. They haven't put that public. So we've thought about potential reasons why they haven't been able to do it, trust being one of them.
Yeah.
Because it obviously, you need a very trustworthy situation for this to happen because it's longer than, you know, a week or so. But yeah, we're definitely addressing that. That's been high on our priorities.
Okay, cool.
Do you have any kind of check or validate the host? For example, like immigration could be not suitable, or the host could be.
So on the profiles, you have sort of pictures of the houses and stuff like that in terms of suitability of accommodations. And you know, even on Airbnb, you have to scan your driver's license in order to be verified as a host or a guest. And if you're a refugee or an asylum seeker, you get an immigration card when you come to Australia. So often they may not have a proof of identity or a driver's license, so we're thinking we can use their IMI card as an identity verification.
And we'll be asking for police checks.
Yeah, police checks as well. Like Uber does for their drivers, so we will have that as well.
Just one quick question. Is this a purely social enterprise, or is it going to be profit? Is it?
So Refugees Welcome is an organisation that's recently registered as a charity, so they sort of have some volunteers on the ground doing it in a very manual way at the moment. You know, I'm pretty passionate about social enterprise, so for me, I would think of ways to reinvest the profit back into the core purpose, but at the same time I understand in terms of business structures and stuff like that, if we want to see private investment, we may need to look at alternative funding sources like impact investing and stuff like that.
So where's your revenue?
So we've done a bit of thinking about revenue. One is sort of through that partnership with Airbnb. If we are solving a problem for them, we can sort of you know, potentially get some revenue through them or ongoing funding through them. We've also looked at having the hosts subscribe, so and we could sort of reward hosts like that and have a network of hosts, and while they're not hosting, they could stay in each other's houses. Say if I'm going to Melbourne, I could stay in a host house there, and that's the sort of value proposition that would incentivize them actually paying for the service rather than
And we've also looked at other things as well. So there was the government funding. The Brisbane Council recently got refugees in Brisbane, $2,000. They also was reasonably successful crowdfunding in Brisbane as well.
And I think the tech behind that, I think there's a market opportunity there as well. But if you look at industries like ageing, I know the Australian Centre for Social Innovation is doing a similar thing in the ageing sector. So if we can build a technology solution to sort of change the front end of it and make it suitable for the ageing sector or the homeless sector. And in ageing sector, if you have more of a home share more generally, you could have people paying rent and generate revenue that a few options that need exploring.
There was also the data that we will collect, which we can use maybe like to give to the council and
generalized
data, like not specific information, but how many refugees there are, so they'll have like proper statistics and things like that. So
and real
we
life.
Could
yeah,
give
real
them,
life.
We could ask for a fee for that information.
It could help with health scores, just so that I know the distribution of refugees in certain areas at certain times, because the stays through this program are quite short, so they could know where they're moving to and where to put more funding into.
Okay.
Well, good.
Have you ever come to a crossroad in your life where a little bit more information would have helped you make the right decision? Imagine spending 4 years studying a bachelor, 10 years in industry, becoming an expert in your field, then having your life turned on its head and being forced to move to a new country. Finding that your qualifications that you've had where you were are worthless. Start again. Australia is a country of fantastic opportunities. However, there is a disconnect between the information available for new refugees of what opportunities are out to what they have in front of them. We are here to solve that information disconnect by addressing the problem of hard to understand and hard to access information. Pathways will be an online portal where users input their own data and get tailored results for potential options and pathways for them. The pathways will be transparent, actionable, and informative. 200,000 refugees and migrants come to Australia every year, but only 1/3 of them are able to be have their skills recognised. The recognition process is fragmented and lengthy, and is very difficult for the person.
Now, our minimum viable product is going to be a web-based solution. So we're going to have an embedded Google Sheet in here, which is going to have reliable, relevant information from already existing online sources, but all collated together in one easy-to-access database. So a user will come in, they'll have a series of questions, they're going to fill out what's the important information, that will be then sent to us at Pathways. Now in the pilot stage at the moment, we'll assess those individual claims, compare it with the Google Sheet we have with the available options and pathways, and then send that back to the user client. From the user perspective, this is going to be no cost and no subscription. Now I'd like you guys to all meet Navid. So Navid here, he's come to Australia from Iran with a Master's in Electrical Engineering. He's in the 25 to 35 age bracket. He has no formal English qualifications and no local work experience as yet. Now, as you can imagine, he's come to Australia excited to start his new life here after a big lengthy process of all the other things he has to go through. But he's told straight away, no local experience, no accreditation, no job. Now, when he first arrives here, how is Navid meant to know that there are scholarships available here for refugees for university? How is he meant to know that there are accreditation processes in place for people like him? The user experience we see for someone like Navid would be they'd come in, give us that information that we need, we can give them the output of 4 specific ways, pathways for him to pursue his goal, whatever that may be. So we're going to be giving them the options and pathways that are available. Now, Pathways is going to give refugees and migrants, new Australians here seeking employment, a quicker pathway to success. We think we're going to be able to increase refugee employability, but more importantly, give them ownership of their own opportunities that are already available. There is a significant incentive
for people like the industry skills councils to satisfy the skills gaps that they have in high demand industries here, and we're going to be able to give that information to the specific individual that's our user. And potentially existing job service providers like Refugee Talent or potentially individual caseworkers for refugees, they can use us as a source of information to give their clients more informed decisions about their pathways that are available.
Cool, thank you. To begin our journey, our key strategic and channel partners in mind are education providers, training community organisations, migrant services and recruiters. Our business model is based on providers paying a fee or commission per candidate referrals or placements at the end. We'd also look for support from education and training partners to provide revenue by paying to promote their institution within our platform, especially if their results came up naturally. So we wouldn't mess with the results, it would just be a matching process. With Australia's steady intake of refugees and migrants, the long-term sustainability is evident. However, initially we're prepared to dedicate the man hours required to build success stories in South Australia before upscaling to a more automated approach and then extend nationally. A key challenge is to measure the success of our recommendations, outputting satisfied users and sharing these stories with Australia and the world. Our rollout plan is based on community engagement and organisational awareness. After we have helped...
How does a recently arrived migrant or refugee find out about this program?
So we were hoping to, through organisational awareness, so partner or at least engage with organisations like the Red Cross and make a pack, like a welcome pack. Hey, these are the things you can do. From interviews, we found that it's kind of the process is you're servicing the top priorities, so it's food, shelter, that kind of thing. You kind of moved along the journey, and education is so far down the line. We need to get to the next person, so we're hoping that they will see it as a true benefit for them and go, hey guys, I'm going to help some more, this is you off our sheet.
Okay. The intervention is key.
Yeah. The refugees we've spoken to, they mentioned things like having caseworkers, so which is why I think that for them this would be so easy for them to just quickly fill out the questionnaire for their client, and then the rest is up to them, so we're giving them those options. So it doesn't have to be the individual, our client could potentially be someone larger like a caseworker.
Is there any way, for example, to reach age goal, there is many pathways, so is there any way to vet or validate or maybe get feedback from anyone across these pathways, get feedback about that pathway?
Yeah, definitely tracking the usability, well, the user's story, I guess, and really engaging with them and going, were you happy with where you went, was the information, and just really, I guess, being close to it in the beginning and understanding what any frustrations were or if anything was incorrect before we scale it up. To really ensure we're putting them in the right places, because it is quite crucial. I guess one bit of data we'd want to track is, I guess, tenure for placement. So if we put you somewhere, did you stay there for 10 years, or did you have 12 other jobs in the next month? So being able to track that data and then use that to promote as we upscale and go, 90% of our placements stay in their job for 10 years. So it means they're happy and they got a good job.
I was going to say, so to ensure that communication with what the government needs and what the economy wants, is very important. So constantly reviewing market trends and what's up and coming is very important. And so within that, that will become part of the decision and process of what's displayed at the end. So for example, manufacturing in South Australia may be on the decline, but agricultural is going up. So if a person has transferable skills between automotive and agriculture, they may be suggested to move in that direction.
That's why we didn't want to go automated straight away, because it's kind of hard to track if your automated results are going to be successful. So that's why we wanted to make the pilot phase, Adelaide smaller phase first, more individual, so we can sort of see what options come up. Yeah, and the idea is give them as many options as possible so that the individual can sort of choose where to go.
So that's what you've got, a platform model. You've got people on both sides. You've got the migrants as well as you've got the businesses, which are your paying customers. Have you spoken to any of those folks to figure out what
it is? We spoke to Harari a little bit, being a recruiter, and we did have a little bit of interest that this would be something.
Could you sign up?
It wasn't a hard sell, that was fine. But yeah, there was interest there.
So In your online platform, I saw that you had questions about what degree they've studied. What other ways could, you know, regardless of what someone studied, they may still have a lot of other skills. So is that sort of built in as well, that they can list, or perhaps there are some?
We wanted to have it's like a sort of discipline section. So we've spoken to a few skilled refugees and skilled migrants that have come, so they have a qualification in this engineering and they don't want to do that anymore. So we wanted to first focus on skilled refugees, but now we've sort of expanded a little bit further into those that want to be skilled. So for example, if you have an IELTS score but you don't have any official university or TAFE diploma qualifications, that would be one of the options. Whereas,
And so if you...
For instance, if you're a builder, you might have 10 years of experience being a builder. That information could go into that section, and then it would pop out. You need to be registered with the Australian Master Builders Association, and then you're up and running. So kind of just giving them that information really clear. Or on the flip side, being transparent with information and going, look, if you're a doctor, you're going to have to start again at the beginning. That's your assessment to make. So being transparent with the information as well. So there's the hope is managed up front, so you're not kind of getting all excited and then falling off a cliff. You're managed from the word go.
Yeah, but our interest is really important for this as well. So not just your accreditations, but where do you want to go?
So if you have a look at the scholarships, if you are interested, you've mentioned you were interested in studying blah, you may be eligible for such and such scholarship. This will assist you on the way. So, yeah.
Centrifuge. That is Smith, that is Salim, and my name is Simon. The problem statement that we actually wanted to go for was more the communication, networking, and temporal issues that NGOs and refugees faced when communicating with each other.
Alright, so Azim, he flew to Alad Airport from Sudan in 2011. It was a harder time period for him because he couldn't understand English language. So, because adjusting in a new society and language, it was intimidating. So, his journey was already problematic. So, it was really hard to find a right place and use to be Petumba Toglake. So, after really struggle, he found an NGO to contact with his housing, food, and settlement. So, the NGO put him in a waiting list. So if there's a place, then he can live in a house. So after 3 months, he settled his house, settlement, and he just settled everything which is useful for his life.
Okay, to talk about the impact, what Centrifuge is trying to create is, it's trying to reduce the amount of time that it takes to for a person to get the opportunity. So reducing time for the refugee and the NGO and the any agency that is involved with it, solving real problems, accessing data in real time, and dedicated resources where they're needed. Also connecting with other refugees is an impact that it creates. So some of the focus points that our app tries to achieve are networking issues, housing issues, and creating jobs and volunteering opportunities. Just to give you a bit of a demo of our product, before that, this product we're designing by an assumption that technology is not for, like, everybody doesn't have technology. So we are actually saying that we will be doing programmable SMS as well as part of this. So people who do not have a smartphone can access this technology. By doing programmable SMS, they can register for a interest for a job that may be available in their area. So the app is actually creating jobs based on their geolocations. To give you the demo, this is basically a wireframe of our app for the refugees to work on. If we just go on the demo,
so the demo is actually on this screen, so we're not going to worry about that.
Is it not going? It's not working.
No.
Okay. So basically, they fill in their information using their mobile number. They go and subscribe to dynamic and active lists, which is housing, legal, or whatever. We are focusing on housing for the time being. They're presented with a lot of opportunities in their area. We also collect metadata, which we can use, which can be used by third parties and agencies like so. So third parties like the government, Red Cross, AMRC, they can use and dedicate their resources saying that, okay, if the search criteria is housing, there are 23 people who are looking, and they're actively, there are only 18 which are available. So they can actually dedicate their resources to just fill up those five, which is the gap in that area. So we can do that mapping for the agencies. And yeah, so providing this real-time information, which is quite current, will help these agencies access data which is not dated through or 2 years old or, you know, more than that. To talk about the future Centrifuge, here's Simon.
Yeah, so obviously in the short term, we aim to put Centrifuge on the map as a not-for-profit organization to open it up as a donation platform. This will enable it to be built and then scaled accordingly, because there is an issue with housing job availabilities, amongst other things. So that's short term. The medium term is to actually increase the digital identity presence within the platform. So anyone overseas can actually use their identity, which will then be able to be used within Australia Post as well. And long term is to actually purchase land and property around the world for future designs, shared economies like this. By having these dedicated in certain countries, we don't need to actually find a place or someone that has a room available, because these will be made available. So that's the Centrifuge. If you head over to centrifuge.org, the website is live, and we do aim to launch early September, later this year. So thank you very much, everyone. So our revenue model comes via a subscription from the NGOs to access the data, which is anonymized.
That's the only source.
There are other ways. There is donation platforms. There is potential depreciation value that comes from the actual housing that is built under the Centrifuge name. But we weren't really going for a revenue model per se, because it's not a massive focus point. The focus point is building a community within the application. It is a digital assistant to connect NGOs to refugees.
What's the unmet need for those people that want the data? What are they really missing?
Yeah, so we spoke to people from Red Cross. They said that the two main problem areas for them is there are not enough opportunities. So we as a company cannot manifest opportunities for them, but what we can do, and the second thing is that it's not reaching masses on time. So basically trying to optimize the time that it takes when an opportunity is generated by a service provider or an agency to reach the masses. Right now what's happening is...
I guess my question is, what data are you going to be providing them that they don't currently have access to?
So they have access to data which is not real time. They have access to data from ABS which is 2 years old. But right now if they come onto the application, they have data which is, suppose there is a 15 opportunities available, but there are 50 people looking for it. So that data can be utilized and taken to the government and said that, okay, we need to put the resources there instead of another area. So the dedication of resources can be optimized in that way.
How you validate this data? Like if someone signed up in the app, said I'm looking for a job, how you can find this one? It's like asylum seeker or refugees or someone. Like
so when we collect the metadata, we understand where they're coming from or take that information. If they're not able to provide that information directly to the app, a volunteer can help to gather that information and put it on the system for them.
Because for example, if someone can sign up and say that I'm looking for a job, but they don't have work rights in Australia. So there is risk behind the
yes.
data.
So as and when they will provide that information, validating would probably working with their caseworkers or agents can help achieve a better information that they get on the app that is shown to them.
if we could find you some investment, would you consider being a for-profit company?
Yeah, we did. We're going to go with the term profit for good to kind of emphasize that that profit for good means that, yeah, you can be a profit company and have good intentions in mind. And that's kind of what we were going for. And I think, like, if it was to start off as a non-for-profit, it opens up the avenue for donations amongst other things. Obviously, I'm not an accountant, I'm not a lawyer, I don't know the, like, you know, the legalities to it, but then it would have to be changed to potentially allow for, you know, more community built effort. But yeah, very open to definitely scaling it a little bit better and globally.
You can actually start a trust fund.
Yeah, many trust funds.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Any other questions?
Any other questions, yes.
Terrific, well done, thank
yeah.
you. Lucky last.
So, Juma came to Australia in 1999 with his family. They had to flee their homeland of Afghanistan because of terrorism, war, and so forth. So when he came to Australia, he faced difficulties such as language, the different environment, and cultural barriers. But for his children, it was much easier. They went to school, they learned the language through there, they made friends through there. But for him and his wife, they faced many difficulties trying to find a house, trying to find employment, and then, you know, you go through appointment after appointment after appointment. So, Juma is my dad. When he came to Australia, he went through the whole process and it took him years to start settling in and making friends. But it shouldn't be like that, it shouldn't take that long. But unfortunately, there are thousands upon thousands of refugees that come to Australia and they face this exact problem. So we are trying to come up with a real world solution to you know, engage with social inclusion and cultural exchange.
So we met with Reverend Lily McLaughlin, a fantastic, sorry, give me a second. It may have died. There we go. A fantastic Afrikaans woman who runs Random Acts of Welcome, which is a local initiative that brings refugees together based around food. We traveled deep into the signalless hills of Adelaide, where she treated us to this fantastic party dinner and an amazing mean rooibos tea. Through her experience bringing refugees together, she gave us some insight into the challenges refugees face, such as this lovely Muslim lady and child that she helped through her events. And she said something really beautiful. Just like Bez's dad, life was appointment to appointment, only leaving the house to travel or buy food. She said as such and profoundly thanked Lily for providing her with the opportunity to experience life and community again for the first time since leaving her home. Lily believes in a pretty straightforward motto that we hope to adopt, and that motto is to welcome, to belong, to thrive. Unfortunately, the solution is not perfect. Lily and the other event runners talk about the problems they face around technology, communication, and dealing with fractured solutions.
This is where our solution, Kultgroup, comes in. A mobile and web application that connects refugees, migrants, new and old Australians, over one commonality, a joy of food. Kultura is an application that builds bridges between cultures and community. We designed a simple and intuitive user interface that relies heavily on the use of icons and images to help refugees navigate through the workflow as they may have language difficulties. In addition, we also provide the service in common other languages. Key information provided by users includes their interests, dietary requirements, such as whether they can only eat halal meat, and other information, such as their nationality. This information is used by organisers, which can be anyone, to best accommodate these guests. Once in the event, users can see who they'll be dining with, a little bit of information about the users, and there'll also be an option to start a dialogue before the event with a simple chat interface.
break it down, it comes down to one thing: food. I mean, I know I'm from a Greek background, so I know food's a big thing in my family, but it's a universal thing, food. I mean, everyone sits down, and basically the idea is to get refugees, Australians and immigrants to come together over food. So what we're doing is we've got two rollout plans. We're partnering with restaurants to offer heavily subsidised food for refugees. Now, we've actually called these people and got them down for our initiative. They've actually agreed to have heavily subsidised meals. And the second thing is to have community collaboration between different organisations, just like Random Acts of Welcome, where it already has an installed user base, and it's just the issue is disjointed amongst the South Australian community. Now, all of our apps, all apps worry about barriers and low adoption rates. Now, we're combating that with two things. We're offering a $5 voucher for the first 50 users that sign up, and also we're offering a unique multicultural experience that isn't found anywhere else.
Lily has shown that low-impact, low-technology solutions have the ability to work, but they lack the ability to stay connected and they don't cooperate with one another. What solutions exist are fractured, poorly advertised, and impact only a very small percentage of the refugee population at large. Refugees, both through Random Acts of Welcome and other initiatives, frequently wish to be involved with people outside the refugee space, including interacting with Indigenous persons, successfully settled migrants, and Australians who are friendly towards people of that nature. An overwhelming majority of currently existing solutions are small one-man army operations who have great knowledge of their community, but are frequently lacking the skill set or even in some cases the desire to scale. Despite this,
our financial expert. Uh-huh. So perhaps you'd like to speak a little bit about our revenue streams.
Yeah. Well, when we get asked.
Yeah. I think you're
someone
asked
about your revenue. Excellent. Thank you, Nihal. That's perfect.
Revenues we have discussed with working at other restaurants and possibly working with the council. We have looked into it short term around $2,000 and longer terms for $8,000. Besides that, the key here is frugality, leveraging already existing networks. The key is that we can do this ourselves, we can make the website, make the app, like all this, it's quite easy. The timing of like hiring servers is quite cheap. We can do that if we want. We can talk to other corporations and whatnot to discuss leveraging existing networks. But the key is just low costs and leveraging existing networks. Yep.
And one of the things that we found was like restaurants were very willing already for who we were talking to provide $50 a month just for the purpose of advertising on our platform in addition to that. So just from every restaurant we're going to be partnering with, that's $50 a month. That adds up.
Eventually, we may later down the track pivot, seeing how traction goes, so maybe a subscription or premium model. We do have our regular attendee possibly with refer a friend, bring a friend along, so grow potential more users in. So come to the second event, bring a friend. Again, as that was discussed, and we will discuss it more after this event, all possible opportunities.
What's the ideal kind of group size for these events?
So we have, at the restaurant idea, we want around 10 people from different backgrounds to come together, experience. So the restaurant thing is the Ghan is Afghan food, right? But you want people from different cultures to experience Afghan food. The other one is Ethiopian food, but you know, you want 10 different people to go there. That's one pathway. The other pathway that Costa discussed was through the community rollout, where we have existing organisations like the one that Lily runs, where they already have these kind of things once a month, once a fortnight, very disjointed, it's hard to get numbers. But if we can get them together through this technology, you know, and then you can have numbers up to 20, up 30, or if you want, there's a possibility, you can say, I'm looking to have, you know, share my lunch with a person from a different culture, I just want one person there, or two people. Then, see, the two pathways that we organise are sort of like, okay, this is through us, we have the opportunity to organize a meetup between other people. You say, okay, I'm going to put up, not an ad, but you know, I'm free today at lunch 1 to 2. Who wants to join me? 2 people join you, 10 people join you, it's up to you. And you have the ability to accept the request and say, sorry, you know, only 3 people. So there is that pathway as well. So group size, I guess, is, sorry, it's up to you.
Terrific. Thank you very much.